You, so you hear me well. It's okay. So thank you very much for this invitation. And as I said just before, everyone come inside. I prepare a speech where I most present some of the main aspect of the approach I develop. But for sure, feel free to stop me, to exchange, to ask questions, to give point. So it's better if it's not a monologue when I just speak, and I will be happy to have your reaction. So what I would like to begin to evoke is the necessity or the need to have a different view about what we understand of policy process, that what we can call the dominant view. As you know, probably I don't know if you are all familiar or more or less with the policy studies literature, but what is really dominant in the policy literature is what we can call the non-criticized approach or the positivist approach or and when we try to understand when it come from, it specifically come from US initially, and the idea that study public policy around 1970s is study a process with a classical object, which is policy, you can change, and when we can find some easy causality. And probably with a normative aspect also, when we can find a better way to find to solve problems. So there is this kind of dominant aspect in the literature, which begin in 1970, and sure complexify with the literature. It's complexifying more and more since 30 years, but it continued to be a perspective. The dominant perspective continue to consider that we have a process, a system, more or less easy, but where we can find causality of how we are governed and how public policy exists, change, and are making. So one thing is for me very interesting is the fact to consider that there is very not a lot of place about what I can call the indeterminate aspect and dimension of the policy process itself. All the view we observe the policy process is more or less have an idea about it's something like determined process. And the second point is the difficult way to grasp the political dimension of the policy process, which is necessarily unpredictable. So this indeterministic part of the policy process and the important part of policy of political dimension, which is really less or poorly taking into account in all of policy studies. Is something which is in the beginning of my research and how I want to examine it. The second point I want to highlight is about discursive practice, but for sure it's linked. What is I can't say that the discursive practice, I come back later about what I call exactly discursive practice. I can't say that the policy studies don't take into account seriously discursive practice because there is, but sometimes there is a difficulty to have a clear view about how what is mean observing the discursive practice of policymakers. So in the literature, we found an interest about the definition of the problem. I think it's more or less a consensus in all the academic literature to consider that a problem is not a problem by itself. We need to focus on what we can call the critical dimension and the definitional dimension of the problem, how people transform a situation into a problem, and it's a definitional dimension. And definitional dimension is one of the important discursive activities. We have also the idea that we need to observe the political discourse, even if most of the time the policy studies say, it's more an idea that political discourse is what we need to be careful. The researcher seems to be careful about what political discourse is. So showing political discourse is a way to observe that there is a gap between political discourse and reality that we can observe. We have also a mixed in the literature about ideas, belief, representation, narrative. But more of the time, it's diffuse, it's sparse, it's not really a coherent view about what is the role of discursive practice in the policy process. So what I would like to present to you is three main points in my speech. The first one is what I call the discursive practice, and why we need to observe it. The second point will be more about what discursive practice we find in the policy process, and where it takes place exactly. In what condition people have the right to discuss, to criticize, to argue. And the last point is what we learn from discursive practice, and more specifically, what we learn about the political dimension of the policy process through the study of discursive practice. So this is the three main points I would like to highlight. So first point, why I speak more about discursive practice than discourse, for example. I use the idea that discourse must be interest because it is first an activity, as an activity. And the critical perspective on discourse is not just to produce discourse, it's also to consider that discourse is always, and for most of you, I suppose it's something obvious, it's inside action. Discourse is in action. Discourse is a practical practice. It's Foucault who say we need always to observe the materiality of the discourse. And this materiality is what is really important. Where is the materiality? Is where who speak where to when. So this is why I want to make a difference between the discursive analysis, where people have tendency to only study the discourse far away of the practice. Specifically, when you try to do something really quantitative, you need to just forget where people have speak, how they have built their discourse, to who they are speaking. So discursive activities, discursive practice is to come back to this materiality. It's also a rejection of the concept of ideas. I also come back to Foucault. Foucault says, behind the discourse, there is nothing. Don't try to find all the time something like ideas, like representation. No, discourse is discourse. We can study the repetition of the discourse, but discourse is the materiality. So this is why I don't like the concept of ID, because the concept of ID is immaterial. It's something of flight, but it's not a social and political activities. So this is why I speak about discursive activities more than discourse, because I think that one of the main transformation in the social science we have is to the end of the gap between people who study social and political activities without the discourse and people who study the discourse without being interested about the political and social activities. So focus on the discursive activities is a way to better understand this. I don't say that all activity contain discourse, but I say that all discourse is always inside an activity that we need to take into account. It's also a way to be to make a distance with the discourse. It is Wittgenstein who say, for example, that we need, each time we study the discourse, the main problem is how the meaning can highlight us too much. And we have difficulty because we need words to study words. And this idea of observing the activity is something who can help us to take some action in the discursive activities. I would like to evoke seven kind of activities. I go quickly, but if you are interested, I can go slower and develop some aspects. So please really be free to explain. Some is very classical and some will be more a way to switch after on the policy process. What about the activity of the policy process itself? But I want to be sure that where I come from to say what I'm. So the first one, very classical, is to say, okay, the discourse is linked to the importance we give to the reflexivity of people. Discourse is used to grasp reality. Everyone needs to be this, to grasp the reality with the discourse. So if you, there is no knowledge without discursive activities, and there is no discursive activities without knowledge. It's, for example, it's classical on Habermas, who say that our cognitive ability cannot be longer independently of our linguistic ability to think and our ability to act. So this is an important point to say that every aspect of the first, the reflexivity is important, and this reflexivity is not a thinking separate from acting, is inside the discursive activity. And why is also important is also because the language is the indispensable filter to grasp the reality, but is also a filter who transforms this reality. It's not neutral. Foucault again say that discourse is an act of violence that we do to things. So we need to observe as a way to grasp the reality, but also a way to transform this reality. I like one of the distinction, classical distinction used by Boltanski, a famous French sociologist, a critical sociologist, who say that we can maybe use differently the concept of reality and the concept of world. The reality is what the world is, what exists, and the reality is what we grasp with the world when we want to grasp this world. So the world we have with the reality, the social construction of this reality, is all the time more organized than what is the reality itself. But reality is not outside. I come back on this. So this is the first point, give importance to the reflexivity. And if you observe most of the policy studies, they don't really take importance to this reflexivity of people, how people grasp around them the world, how they understand this. The second dimension, which is important, is to consider that discursive activities is nothing else but a game of language, to take the expression of Wittgenstein, to build meaning, creating interaction. How you people create collective meaning, it's also because they create this, they use this game of language. And behind the game of language of the concept and the view of Wittgenstein, what is really interesting, and I will use it in the second part, this is why I just evoke it quickly, is to consider that we are not prisoner. When we observe people using the language, we need to observe it as it's a strange language. When they arrive to build a meaning that we not know necessarily, but which is important to create a collective meaning. So game of language will help us, this concept will help us, for me, to better understand one of the main enigma of the policy process studies is the link between problem and solution. I will come back on this after if you want, because it's probably one of the most interesting things on this. So discursive practice is in the center of every interaction. And what is important is for meaning, not meaning absolute meaning, but what is important is how each person understand each other and build collective, this collective meaning. So three, the third dimension I want to take into in account is the classic, all the dimension is really classical, it's not really original. I'm sorry about this. It's to consider all the time that every discursive practice is action by itself. There is all the time a performative dimension of the discursive action. So it means that when we observe, and if you come back to Austin, for example, do things with words, if we observe, we always be to separate the intention of the speaker, but which is not necessarily that we can understand just through the word we observe, the intentional consequence of what the speaker say, and the unintentional consequences of what people say. And we need to take this three dimension all the time, because there is too many times when we analyze the discourse through the consequences, which is not necessarily expected by the speaker. And this is one of the problems of the discourse analysis. So, which means that we need to be careful about this. So I think that here I have no difficulty, but sometimes depending of the people I speak about, sometimes it's difficult to better understand how words can be action. But I like to take this fighting example of, you know, in Spain, when there is this conflict between the prime minister and the president of Catalonia, because to say the prime minister of Spain say, do you have say clearly that you are independent or you have declared, you have claimed the independency of Catalonia or not? Do you have say that? It's not clear. So if he say that, he go to prison. So it's something interesting. So four, discursive action is also very discursive activity is also important, because like this, we never separate, but inside the discursive activities, we have the content of what people say, but we have the identity of what people say. So we can speak about Mead, we can speak about Gusfield. What people say engage, it's kind of acknowledgement of the people. So inside the discursive activity, all the time, people play their own identity. And it's a dimension that we need to never forget. So criticize a speaker is also criticize. To criticize someone, you can criticize what he said, but you can criticize his position, his skill, or whatever. So if you don't separate the discourse analysis from who speak and what's happened, you have better understand how the identity of the speaker is all the time linked. And I like the concept of Gusfield that I use a lot, of ownership. People is owner of what the statement they found. I come back on this. So five, we need to consider this discursive activity specific in one of the main important activities specifically for the policy process is how they create collective action and coalition. There is a lot of literature about collective action. It's not new, but a lot of this literature is not really be interested necessarily about the role of the discursive activities, except, so sure, some Habermas or some other, but we can come back. So what is important for me is to consider how people enroll, argue, not for argumentation, but to enroll and to convince or to pursue people to join their problem statement or their policy solution statement. In a lot of literature of policy studies, this is very interesting to observe that the question of creation of the coalition is not a question. It's not an enigma by itself. You say Sabatier, for example, there is, okay, people have the same beliefs, they create the same coalition. Advocacy coalition. No, I don't believe to this. Okay, so to say that. I think that we can observe how people fight to create the coalition itself, how they try to enroll. And after, I can give you a lot of empirical examples that I study about this. So, six is to consider also the criticized dimension of the discourse. And I think it's very important. We discuss about the critical approach, and you know, maybe that in specifically in France, but not only, one of the main movements coming 20 years ago is to say that we go from critical sociology to sociology of critics. It's one of the main movements is to say we need to understand what is the role of the critics inside any process we want to examine. So Boltanski is one of the main figures of this movement to say, okay, let's take attention to the criticize itself, which is an important activity. And criticize is a way, is an important way of fighting. There is not only movement of create coalition, there is also movement of fighting. And the fighting is important. And the last dimension I want to highlight, probably which explain and mixed all the other, is the question of power. Discursive activity is always a question of power. Probably it's a difference I have with modestly with Habermas, who try to differentiate what he called something with a strategic dimension, which is more how someone have introduced power inside the discourse, with what he called communication logic, where there is like an equivalence of everyone who arrive to find an agreement through their argument. I don't believe to this option, and I think, and it can be a big debate, that we need to consider that because each discourse is inside the discursive activities, and each discursive activities engage yourself and your identity, it's engage also your position. And it's engage also the power inside what you say to who you speak and what you want to do. So you know that there is a big debate probably specifically in political science about can we say that there is a power of discourse, or can we say that there is discourse of power? So there is one tradition who think that the discourse is essentially the weapon of the power, and we need to use like this, to observe like this. You find this in Edelman, for example, even on Bourdieu, who play an important role, to say, don't look only to what people say, look at the spectrum, look at who have the right to speak, which is always important. So this is a first idea, but inside also this idea of discourse of power. Habermas, when he writes this book about techniques and science as an ideology, he also explained that when you put power, science and technology through your discourse, you have power. You are the power behind. The discourse appears like a veil, but the reality is a power pre-exists to the position of power pre-exists to the discourse itself, and the discourse is only a weapon. And you have a second tradition, which is more around Foucault, about the idea that the power is inside the discourse itself. And the production of ban words, for example, the production, the mechanism of rarefaction of the world, the production of truth, which is really important in the society. It's the second part of Habermas. This way, I think. And so we need to think together these two dimensions. What I, in all the dimensions, the question of discourse is all the time linked to the power. And we need to interrogate this powerful dimension. And in my view, because in the discursive activity analysis, because you can't separate. This is one of the things. You can't separate the people who speak from what they say. It's the same thing. So it means that you can't separate the power of the people from the power of what they say. And we need to, as I say, as an example, when I studied, for example, a policy decision in a municipality of Paris, it's interesting to observe how people argue to convince the mayor to take this decision and not another one. So when you observe this, you observe two things. First, they recognize the mayor as the decision makers, because if not, they don't address, they argue to them. But if they arrive to convince him, who have the power finally? Because they think they can produce a power, and they can say if they win, but they are someone influent and have a new position. So I think we need to think power and position and discursive activity in the same time. So it's a way to go beyond this separation and this debate between power of discourse and discourse of powers. So this is my first point, is to give you the seven aspects of the discursive activity I want to take in charge when I observe the policy process. And now I would like in my second part to go more in the detail in the policy process itself, because it was very general. What kind of activity, of discursive activities, I think it's really important to observe to better understand. So at the end, we come back on what is innovation, what is not, probably. What is confinement, what is not of an idea. But before this, I want to insist on four specific discursive activities I focus when I study policy process. So the The first one is all the definitional practice. I think it's really central to observe the definitional practice. It's kind of as a game of language. So Wittgenstein considers that definition is a game of language. So there is two, in my view, there is two main, I call this statement. I don't know if it's a good word in English. I have a lot of discussion with my English because I use the term of énoncé, which is used by Foucault. Statement is a kind of translation of énoncé, but probably the concept in French is more complex than the one in English. So I have a lot of discussion about this, but I use statement. What is a statement? Is an organized discourse and in a process of institutionalization. So it means that there is enough repetition of this discourse that we can observe a kind of beginning of stability who put different elements together as a game to construct a meaning. So the most classical one we know, this is not what is original on what I do, it's more the second one, is about the problem definition. We have a lot of literature since a lot of time to say that, to absolutely agree that problem is not something that we need to define. We need to observe the process of definition itself and what I call the definition, the problem statement, how people create a problem statement, how people transform the reality into an unacceptable reality. So we have different categories. I do very quickly because it's more classical and I want to insist more on the second point. Generally, what I observe and what we can observe also in a lot of literature is the addition, the aggregation in a statement, in a problem statement, into five or six important dimensions. The first is the naming itself. So to have a problem, you need to name it as a problem. So sometimes name is just, for example, when I work on housing policy, I was fascinated that everyone speak about housing problem. It's never clear what is a housing problem, but it's something that obvious in all the participants of things, they say there we need to solve the housing problem. So naming could be also an employment. There is sometimes it's a specific word, sometimes not. The second point is a build knowledge and discourse about the public of victim. So a problem needs victims. If there is no victim, there is no problems. So how people arrive to build knowledge about the category of, it's not only one or two victims, it could be a public of victims. So it's a categorization of the public itself. But it's also when they do this, and it's something very important, they also need to define what is a society. You not define only unemployment people, you define also that the society is composed by employed and non-employed. So it's a construction of the society itself. This is why any problem contains a definition of society. The first thing is about a group of guilty, so of culprits. So there is not only victims, there is also guilty people or guilty object. Or so, for example, I worked on pollution you select people select the kind of guilty because there is always different candidate to the guilty problem. In the pollution, you never consider that the wind is guilty, even if the wind is responsible of the pollution, air pollution. Because if there is wind, you have no problem of pollution. So people select what is important. The car pollution is more important than the wind. So when they construct the statement, they give importance to this kind of things. The fourth thing is also the importance of the future. There is a narrative of the future. In a lot of problem, there is a lot of problem statement, we observe a capacity to define a drama future. Sometimes it could be apocalyptic. Sometimes in the shale gas, I work on shale gas, they say no future. So sometimes the future is no future. So when I say good problem, you understand the term good in terms of observing. When a good problem is a problem associated with a future of drama. So we have the new, it's a kind of astrology of the problem. Building the future, giving an idea of the future is really important. And the two last points, is the importance of the responsibility. So a good problem, a public problem is a public problem, and it's a process of what I call the politicization of the problem statement, is to say, to nominate the state or the government as responsible to solve it. It's not mean that people need to solve it or it's easy to solve it, but a good a public problem need to be associated with the government as responsible. Generally, it's outside. It's a kind of criticize. Any problem, it's kind of criticize of the government. The second point I want to observe in the definition is more, is I can say that in problem definition is really classical. The second one is less, is probably how people define proposal. How they build solution. And it's one of my main criticisms about the literature of policy studies is to say that we not observe, a lot of authors not observe problem, but they observe solution. We spoke about formulation, which is not definition. We can discuss about the difference, but they're not really interested by the definitional process of a proposal. And you see there is an extraordinary controversy in the literature, which is not necessarily highlighted, between two kind of traditions. There is a tradition who say that solution is linked to the problem, is linked to the problem solving, first tradition, is linked to the problem framing, a more constructivist, you have the rational tradition who say that there is a link from the solution to the problem, which is the problem solving and policy analysis things. But you have also another tradition, which is more critical, to say we need to have a constructivist view, and in this constructivist view or in critical policy argument, we observe that there is a framing from the definition of problem to the other. This is the first tradition. And you have a second tradition to say, no, there is no link. It's a kingdom tradition. It's a Cohen-Marshallson tradition. Say, no, if we observe, problem solution is developed, made independently from the problem. And after there is like coupling. So it's not the same. And why they have so different view about this? And I think that the one of the way to answer to this question is to go deeper inside the definitional process of the policy proposal. When you observe this, you observe two different important moments. So first, you observe that there is a very similarity. Some of the dimension is really similar to the problem definition. I mean that first thing is labeling. Labeling, naming. Probably it's more important than the naming of the naming of the problem itself. A lot of time problem, we say, oh, it's a problem. But solution, there is a symbolic of the name. So if you say, I don't know, for example, I give you a French example, but probably you have a lot of common example, when there is the project of law to authorize the homosexual wedding, marriage, they call this the mariage pour tous, marriage wedding for everyone. So it's a naming choice. It's something very important. So there is a fighting against the naming. Lockdown is the naming. We can speak about a lot about you. You remember the different discussion about even the name of the virus. So the first thing is naming. So there is a fighting against naming. The second thing is, and probably it's one of the difference with the problem, is a solution is always associated to an instrumentation. It means there is something more concrete inside the solution. It could be a text of law, it could be a budget, it could be something. There is an instrumentation of the process of proposal. The first thing is the opposite view, it's a mirror view of the problem, is to say that there is a public of beneficiaries. You have the public of victim in one part, but you have the public of beneficiaries. We can say, is it the same? I come back on this, but there is a public of beneficiaries, which is really important. But there is no instrument of policy without people who win and people who lose, which is something very important to understand. And this is one of the main political dimensions. If you say you lock down the population and you have just, you let open only the shop, which is essential, you need to define what is essential. So yeah, there is people who win, people who lose. I don't know in different countries. I remember in France, for example, there is if the book shopping is essential or not. There is a big discussion about this. So it's interesting to understand, and there is a lot of consequence. It's not just a discursive fighting. You decide to be closed or to be open. So there is always beneficiary and non-beneficiary. The fourth dimension is probably the more important, but I think we need to observe and would solve probably one of the main problems of the link with the brand. If a problem not need a solution need a problem to exist. So what I think, what I try to observe and what I develop as idea, as hypothesis, is to say that there is a lot of discursive strategy used by the authors to coupling the problem to their own solution. But for this, there is a cost. The cost for them is to transform the problem itself. They transform what I call, US scholars like to speak about weak problem. I prefer to speak about wild problem. There is two kinds of problems. There is wild problem and there is the domesticate or the taming problem. I will give you an example and what kind of strategy it will be used. In the if you say, for example, unemployment or poverty, which is typical a wide problem. There is no way to take it. So there is no solution for this. But if you say, for example, come back to, sorry for the different French example, if you say, for example, that the problem of the causality of the problem of unemployment in France is the rigidity of the labor code, you have addition causes to your problem first. But when you change, you add the cause to your problem, for example, the rigidity of the labor code, you have not only put a cause to a problem, you have changed your problem. You have switched your problem. You have changed. The problem was unemployment. Suddenly, the new problem become the rigidity of labor code. It's a change of, you shift. You try to shift the debate. The debate is not yet at unemployment. It's about the rigidity of labor code. And what is the difference? This is a taming solution because you have a good solution for this, changing the labor code. You have no solution for unemployment, but you have a solution for the cause of unemployment. This is why this strategy that I call the domestication of the wide problem is one of the ways to understand why in the same time solution is independent and solution is independent. It's not only a problem of framing, it's a problem of taming, it's a problem of of how people change the problem we have to be sure that they find have a solution. It's Wildavsky who say a good policy analysis is a policy analysis when we arrive to find a solution to an when a solution have already a, when a problem have already a solution. Sorry. So okay, a good problem is a problem where we have the solution. So this problem of modification is really important in my view. So this taming a wild problem must be probably, I hope, will become a really important way of. So when I say that, so we have these two definitions of activity, which is important. And I would like to highlight also two other activity, enrollment and fighting. I evoke this in the previous point. I think that it's we know that no policy process can be with one or two or three people. Decision is always linked to a lot of people. So the question is how a proposal become a strong proposal. There is a definition of activity, but it's not enough. It's not someone alone who do this. It's also linked to the an argumentative activity, which is to enroll other people that we have a good proposal that we need to share. This very, we need to observe with glasses very deeper the activity of bureaucracy, the activity of government in all the dimensions to understand that how a solution, a proposal coming from one or two persons become a coalition solution. It's a process. And this process is really interesting because it play a role not only in terms of activity of enrollment, but also it has an influence on the statement itself. Because a good enrollment is an enrollment when I prove to someone else that you also can be an owner of the proposal. Don't forget that any proposal is also linked to the identity of this. I give you a simple example to be clear. When I work on the pathway of tramway, so it's easy to understand that I can enroll a mayor of a little city if my my pathway can be changed and can be go to his city. Suddenly, I have a new person in my coalition. So you can change the pathway of a tramway. I study this modification of the pathway and the fight between pathway, for example, with how you can have owner and create your coalition. But it's not only because it's your city. It could be also because it's there is an affrontment between two kinds of expertise. We see in the COVID that sometimes there is some owner of the solution. There is a virologue and the epidemiologist, which is not in the same ownership of solution. So we can observe the different activity of enrollment and ownership. And the last one is about the fighting itself, the struggling. There is no solution because each solution engages an ownership, a change of position, and beneficiary and people who win and people who lose. There is always fighting inside a proposal. And this fighting must be observed because this fighting, how would work this fighting? With criticize. In a lot of space, there is criticize. So this critique activity is really important first to kill some solution. We spoke about innovation probably later, but it's on one of the way to kill an innovation is the criticize argument. One of the main argument, classical argument is not feasible. A bureaucrat, I can show you some empirical example when I see how they kill a lot of solutions, say, no, it's not feasible. Sometimes it's enough to kill a solution. So now we have this definitional enrollment and fighting. We have these different activities. The question is, not hesitate to interrupt me. The question is where it take place, this thing, where we need to observe. Something which is I want to contest, to criticize, is a lot of policy studies consider that there is the world is really easy. There is one, two, or three systems. There is a policy system or policy subsystem. There is a political system. Well, the bad things. There is a policy system, which is serious things. And sometimes you have the problem agenda or something like that. There are two or three systems. Why do they use this? Because a system is a way, is an element of analyze. What I think is a system is not allow us, the concept of system, not allow us to understand the complexity of the policy process and not allow us to better understand what is the way to where the proposal never emerged and what is the way when the proposal emerged, which is also one of the questions of innovation. What I try to observe is to what I call the what where is the scene of debate? Where is the space of debate? I call space of debate something really little, more little than the big system. Space of debate can be an office of administration when there is a debate. Space of debate is material. There is a lot of space of debate. What is interesting is there, I try to complexify the view of the policy process. And what I try to identify is what is the rules of this space of debate. More or less, it's not a stereotype, but it's a categorization. I categorize three types of space of debate. The first one is what I, so the two first one and the third one. The third one is, I opposite, sorry, I try to be more clear as I can. There is one I call is linked to the public space. So when you speak in public and when you speak in private or in hidden space, it's not the same. So when any actor speak in public scene, I call this the forum. This public scene, it could be a public scene for the media, but it could be also when a researcher publishes an article in his own field. So there is not only one forum. Every public space have a specific rule, which is clearly not the same, but the rules of the hidden space. The forum, there is different kind of forum, but the public forum not can't be analyzed as what people thinking. So, for example, I was always fascinated that you, sometimes there is people who study a declaration of the government on what the government says publicly. But what he say, he know that it's performative in the public forums. I work actually on the economical policy during the crisis of 2008. Even a minister of economy never can say that it's a crisis, because if he say that, it provoke also the crisis. So he say, oh, it's not, don't worry. Even if he think that it's not worry, because if he say something else, automatically he provoke something more important than what he did. This performative dimension is one of the rules of the forum. In the hidden space, most of the discussion about proposal is in the hidden space, is not in the public space. It's not mean that public space is not important. So in the hidden space, what there is, I identified two kinds of space. The first one, I call this the atrium. I use a Latin word, the atrium. What is an atrium? It's a house. In an atrium for me is a space of debate where there is a group of dominant actors who totally monopolize with their own argument the space itself. Example, when I just finished a book on shale gas. And when there is some people who say that we need to do this on shale gas, there is an office in the Department of Energy, there is an office with a specialist of shale gas, and they all the time receive the proposal and say possible, not possible, feasible, not feasible. Then in the name of the law, for example, they say there is a big contestation to say there is three shale gas license was given in France. And there is a beginning of contestation. And in the contestation, they say we need to frozen the license. So the office say, people don't understand nothing. It's juridically impossible to frozen. and suddenly the proposal was dead. And what is interesting is this atrium, they are the king of this atrium. They can impose this, and this statement come back until the Ministry of Environment, who declare it's impossible to frozen. But this kind of atrium is not alone in the public, in the hidden space. There is a lot of what I call arena, there is no clear rule. For example, in the bureaucratic space, when you go inside the archive, you observe that the chief of department, in my case, is not exactly work in the same way because you have different way of, for example, you have the classical opposition between the direction of budget and the direction of a policy. And the fighting inside a lot of in the space, I call this arena. What is interesting in my example of Shell Gas, the minister say that it's impossible to frozen, but 4 days later, they decide to frozen. They announce that they frozen. They change their mind. Why they change their mind? Because first, when this statement arrived in the public space, it was very criticized. And second, a group of actors coming from the arena of the department say, we need to just forget this office, which is a specialist of the shale gas, and we need to invent a new word. So they don't call this frozen, but it's equivalent to frozen, to say that we not depend to this office. So there is a lot of strategy. And the world of policy process is a mix between this. When something is blocked, people try to contour. And this is a lesson for the innovation, because we speak probably. So this is the main idea I want to defend, is the policy process. And when I say that, it's not only inside bureaucracy. When I work on Shell Gas, I go inside Total, for example. Inside the company, you have a lot of space of debate, some with a monopole and some with a conflict, and they don't say anything the same between them. There is not, Total is not one. And as the Department of Energy is not one. And there is a lot of fighting and discursive activities inside. Last point, I hope I'm not too long. Yes, I'm too long. No, it's okay. Don't hesitate, and I will finish, and we can end. It's about the political dimension of this. So, why the discursive activities, two kind of discursive activities, and two kind of statement is really a political activity. I'm totally. I would like to explain. There is different conception of politics, and about the links between policy and politics. There is some people who think that it's two different worlds: the world of politics and the world of policy. And the problem is the link between them. I call this an ontological separation between politics and policy. There is some people who think that the difference is only epistemologic. So it means that there is like a politicization of policy, who can become politics or not. And what I think, the third view, it's the first dimension, is to say that no, policy activity is nothing else than political activity. But I need to justify myself about this. So in the literature about what is politics, there is so many that we need days and days and days to discuss about this. But I just want to observe two important dimensions of the politics, which is generally considered as opposite. The first one is the politics considered with the activity of governing, of ordering. It's Weber who says the monopoly of violence. It's Plato who says the science of commanding. It's Bourdieu who speak about the political domination. It's politics is governing, is ordering, is ending social, is ending the conflict, is reestablish security, is establish socialization, is all about ordering society. This is the first definition we find in politics. A second, and you can put, I don't know, education policy is an ordering policy. When you socialize people, you learn them how to, when they have the right to speak, not to speak, blah, blah. Urban policy is also a way to order, ordering the city itself. You have a second definition who come for Carl Schmitt, Laclau, Mouffe, and other, who say, no, you're wrong. Politics is always conflict. Politics is competition, is party, can be partisan competition, is disputing the social order, is contestation. This is politics. I call this the ordering, the disordering dimension. So politics is disordering society. What I think is that it's a French philosopher named Julian Freud who evoked this, who call about the antinomic dialectic of the concept. In the sense that ordering needs disorder and disordering needs order in politics. To have a good, good to governing, you need a disorder. More there is disorder, more you can impose an order. To disordering, you need an order. You need someone to contest. It's like the yin and the yang. It's a dialectic antinomic. So the two, from in my view, two is always linked. You can't thinking one between without the second one, ordering the disorder and disordering the order. It's two activities, it's two political activities, which is central. Ordering the disorder and disordering the order. Why I say that? Because now come back to the idea of defining problem statement and defining proposal statement. What is defining problem statement? Is defining how the society is disordering, is contesting the power, the government to say how you can let this disordering situation. What is statement proposal? Is to say how we can solve a problem, how we can reordering the disorder. Whatever the, it can be an expert, a bureaucrat, it can be a social movement, everyone do politics with public policy. So this is why, for me, there is no distinction between politics and policy. Or defining problem statement and defining proposal solution is always first linking in a dialectic antinomic and two kind of political activity, which is yin and the yang of every society. This is why observing, we can't observing any policy proposal, any innovation, any situation without integrate how it is a political activities, a central political activities which change all the configuration of power of everything. So this is why I want to reestablish, and I conclude on this, I want to push a new kind of perspective, which is a critical perspective, very different but all the tradition of policy studies that we have. We begin to better observe what we have, which means that enter following the career of any proposal, where there was discussed, where there is discussion inside. So as I say, I just published, it was in French, I published two books this year, but one is an edited book about the political, one is in, I make some advertisement. One is a general book about, with Frank Fischer and Zahariadis. So it's an editing book. It's more with a lot of example about this kind of question, how formulation, because problem, a lot of people have considered problem as a political way, but not enough the formulation. And the second one is in French, unfortunately, but the English version is on process. So I hope it will publish in a few months. It's about, it's an empiric, it's a case of the shale gas. How we study in this way, how we understand that the what I call the meaning war, the struggle, the meaning war is a central war in our society. And we can't understand, and not only in the public space, but also in the interaction between the public space and all the hidden space where the public policy is in discussion. So, and I this is how I can try to, in theoretically and empirically, try to develop this idea that observing discursive activity is central to understand what is the power today, and for people who are more imagination, what can be the power tomorrow. Thank you.
Well, thank you for now, for the first round. Well, it's open to anyone who wants to make a comment or a question. I would take the opportunity in my hall to start. I could stay hours here just talking about these topics. It's, for me, it's quite important. And usually when we think about the innovation and the critical innovation studies, I think this approach is underestimated or not really well known by the researchers. So that's why your speech is so instigating for me. Well, I have a list of things that I could ask or questions, but just to start, when you finish your speech, I got myself thinking in which extra lens, if you could say in these terms, should one use to analyze these discursive practices in cases of isomorphic policies? Let me explain a bit more. When we look at innovation policies, even more in underdeveloped countries as Latin American ones, it's quite common to observe cases of isomorphic policies. I mean, usually in the discourse of the most important actors or policymakers mainly, usually we can identify elements as, since these developed countries are doing measures like that, are implementing policy programs in this way, are electing as main areas those ones, we should do the same. So follow the leader, that's pretty much. So I could not agree more with your consideration of the discursive practices, of the importance, how the discourse is construction, the impossibility to separate the object from the subject. But I think what else we should use, or if we need use something else to analyze discourse practices in cases of isomorphic policies?
Maybe we let some people discuss.
Maybe I don't know if some I cannot see any hands up. If you want, if someone wants to express yourself by using your microphone, or you can use the chat, please feel comfortable. I can have a
short commentary. Apologies for not having the camera open. It's better for our quality of transmission here. Many thanks, Philippe, for your much interesting speech. I think this is the kind of, you know, theory approach that should be mandatory curricular unit for every scholar. And I'm an historian, you know, we are very conservative historians. And I acknowledge that it's most interesting to hear you. And I've been following many public policy analyses, and I think it's very, very instigating for us to have you here with us and learning a lot. When you mentioned earlier in your speech that when you put science and technology in your discourse, you have power. I was wondering what would be the difference between power and authority, for example, for a political analysis purposes, and it for me might be interesting to have your answer. And I'm not sure I understand quite well if you mentioned naming and then labeling, there is any difference. I would, maybe you could precise a bit more I find it very, very interesting. Thank you very much once again. You will come in later, maybe second round. I have more questions.
Okay. So, Carolina, I'm not totally sure. I try to have time to really understand your question. So I begin by Thiago,
and I do not make myself clear. Sorry.
I ask you. I try to begin to answer to your question, but I'm not sure I have understand well. So just about the difference between power and authority. For me, it's a question of concept. The concept of authority, I not use it a lot because it's immediately linked to one of the version of the power. You know that there is different definition of the power. Some of them is the power is linked to what I say about power of discourse and discourse of power. So for some people, the position is an authority. So if you are president, you have the authority, but it does not mean you have power. So the power is a concept. An authority can be just a position. What is interesting is a power understanding as an interaction concept. So is the example I gave when I say, okay, someone arrived to convince the mayor, who have the power finally? Probably both. The one who have recognized the mayor as his authority, because he say, oh, you are the mayor, this is why I try to convince you. And it's not only a legal problem, because in France, it was not necessarily the mayor who decide this. But in the same time, if I convince you, I have the power. I win, because you was not in this position before. So what I try to say is that we can have a concept of power which is more interactive, in interaction, when both people win a position. And I think that the concept of position must be understood as a constructivist concept and not as a, it's not a position which is established. Each time someone tried to have to assure a position, he play a role inside. What I mean is, we study actually the crisis of 2008. It's really, really interesting. There is no policy without its side a definition of who is the decision maker. It's not mean that he's a real decision maker. It's not a question. But there is a definition inside. Maybe we can use in this case the name of authority. There is a definition of authority inside. If I want to convince the mayor to do this, I want to decide that he is the decision maker also, even if not necessary. So authority, I take this really as a position, power as an interactive concept, more complex, more linked to the policy process itself, and more diffuse. But your question, if I understand, so there is no, if we come back to the idea that policy process is associated, so public policy is necessarily associated to a lot of power situation and position. So each time you launch an innovation, it's not only a good idea because it's new. It's not only a good way because it proposes a new way to solve a problem. It's also a new distribution of cards of power, a new reorganization of power. You modify, I don't say if it's good or not good, I just say that an innovation is always linked to a change of who has the power. So this is why an innovation is so complex to do, because if it's easy, people can do it. So you have two strategies to arrive to an innovation. The first one is to arrive to share the ownership with someone who has the position and say, oh, I can take this innovation as my innovation and like this, it's okay. Or you need to change his position and to make this in difficult, make it in him or her in difficulty. So this is why there is, for me, there is no policy, there is no discussion about innovation without discussion of politics and power. I'm not sure it was exactly this your question, but maybe you can also reprecise if it was not.
It's fine. Oh, it wasn't in two parts, I can say. This is the first one. And the second one is about isomorphic policies. I mean, when we have experiences of transference of policy, convergence of policy, etc. If you think we should use some extra lens or extra measures to analyze these discursive practices.
It's more a question about what kind of concept we need to use, or it's not more a question about how the government works with I'm not sure if I speak as a researcher who try to understand the government, or if you
let me try to picture a real situation. For example, I have spent my last 10 years analyzing the science, technology, innovation policy in Brazil. And it is quite interesting when we analyze the discourse practices in this policy field. There is a big importance of transferred models or policy models. When we analyze this policy in Brazil, we can see it's quite similar to the policy developed with all the constraints, of course, in terms of money and human resource, but it's quite similar to the same policy in developed countries.
Mm.
Usually countries as Brazil use like OECD countries, European countries as a model, as a reference. So by one hand, we can see all this dynamic among the coalitions that mobilize opinion, or try to gain the game through discursive practice. But on the other hand, since they are using external policies as a model, as a reference, it sometimes makes me think if we should look for, in order to understand this dynamic, if we should look the discourse practices outside either. I mean, it's not like the policy was constructed by the zero. Well, none is made like this way, of course. But it's like the discursive space is not exclusive here, since we are using outside models or outside experience as reference. I'm sorry if I getting so confused.
No, it's okay. I just need it's remember me because I make a speech in Africa, in a country in Africa, and I think there is a lot of debate about are we under control. But my first answer as an observer is to say, are you sure you have observed correctly? What is it exactly? Because they imagine that it's the FMI who is really they put the model of the policy, they constrain the policy and develop the what you call the isomorphism of policy. But when you observe correctly, you observe two things. The first is the isomorphism, you call this is not a real one. And the second is this adaptation is also linked because there is some people who take advantage and policy and power position to use this, even to say that it's outside. So this is why what I push for the analyze part is to say, when you begin do investigation about where the proposal died, where is the symmetry of the proposal? It could be interesting. Who killed when the proposal circulate? And what is the different position of this? And I think it gives you a better idea about what's happened exactly in the government than just think in terms of policy and portation and adaptation. I also forget to answer to about labeling and naming. I, to be honest, it's more my English to change sometimes. It's when you think in a language, most of you know that, except people who think only in English. But So I use the two terms for the same thing, is put a label or a name to something, to do so. You know, it's also interesting to say that only English speaking separate policy from politics. In most of the language, it's the same word. We have politic. And but we need to justify. So in French, we say politique publique and politique, but it's always the same word. So the origin of policy is always interesting. Sometimes some people say it's come from the old French, police. Police is ordering also. So it's interesting, but it's an ordering from government. So this is why it's also interesting, and also to observe how there is some researcher in 1945 work to say that policy is not politics. It's also a way to say we are not politicians and we have something to say about this.
Okay. Yes, thank you. Thank you very much for your presentation with a lot of ideas on how to become the best explorer of policy, and even how to become an innovation killer. Mm-hmm. Maybe I have in mind all the shift in policies in European policies, and the two notions you give about atrium and arenas as a space of policy debates and power debates. And I would like to know your opinion about some kind of normativity in the establishment of frameworks and coalitions, which is common in European policies, for example, with the participation of academic consultants or academic consultancy, lobbies, and think tanks, you know, that is changing from policy in development areas to policies for a good well-being, for policy in the last is mission-oriented policies in innovation. I would like to know your opinion about if these frames are so strong that really preexist to the opportunities or possibilities in for atrium and arenas.
What I think is, I think there is always, so I like the innovation killers, but I think, you know, to shift from a view where you have one, two, three system, which is block or not block, to a world where there is a lot of space of debate in the same time, so it's a more complex world, I think it's also a way to observe that even if there is some strong atrium, there is always a way to follow a new trajectory, to contour some atrium, because there is so many possibilities of pathway to arrive to the decision making. There is never one. And even in any, even if the, most of the solution, most of the of the main entrance is locked down by some atrium, there is always, and it's what I try to show in the case of shale gas when I study, because the question was this: why France was the first country to ban shale gas, when you have the president who think it's a good idea, the prime minister who think it's a good idea, Total, the big company who think it's a good idea, a lot of people. Why we arrived to this situation? And this is why I like this kind of case, because it's not a case when you just verify something. It's a case which is opposite to what we think normally. We say, oh, there is so many strong group interests and politicians, and it's finished. No. At the end, the shale gas was banned in France. And there is a big movement with a lot of, you know, the government changed 4 times of their position. And this is what is interesting me. And what I observe is there is always a new pathway which is possible when people have imagination. The innovation is not inside the policy itself, it's also inside the pathway they arrive to find. Because there is so many ways to observe. So the public fighting is surely an important thing. So if you arrive to impose the idea that shale gas is a bad thing in the forum, mediatic forum, you win a part of the game, but not enough. But you win a part of the game. So you need to arrive to transform the definition of shale gas as a niche, as a political problem that the government want to solve because it's too much an issue for him. And this is how I try to analyze this. So I always think that the policy process is always more surprising than all what we think and what we imagine. There is always surprising thing inside.
Thank you. And the second comment or question, I'm not sure about this, but I really disagree with the idea that innovation has become only as a problem solver. Because I think that innovation and policy, even policies, are wider than this. A political view, a political vision is about the transformation of society. And I don't understand at all why all the ongoing policy discourses are the obsession is with the, I know we have a lot of wide problems, as you say, but I think that at the same time, the technological and scientific advances are showing us that society is not only about problem solving. It's about a vision, and maybe there is, to my view, there is no an open debate in regarding this point. All the problematic, all the discussion about governance is about innovation aimed to problem solving.
I'm agree and disagree with you in the same time. Okay. And I try to explain.
Okay.
What I think is in my last book in 2014, I take the image of Icar. Why is this? What is fascinating is two things. Is all people try to solve problem linked to the government. You're right, it's a focus. The second point is all the big issue of the world never be solved. So the question is, I mean that poverty, inequality, okay, in any country you are, even if it's not the same level, you speak about how to solve the poverty, how to solve the inequality. So there is a problem, which is you have the impression that people use all their time to solve problem, and at the end, problem is always the time here. So it means two things. First, that all the activity to solve problem not solve the problem. So because if they solve, you have not the right problem. The main reason is probably linked to what I explained, is that people not solve problem, never solve the weak problem. They solve the taming problem. So they change the problem to change what is unsolvable. The second thing is why people continue to believe to that. Because we know that no one arrived to solve the big problem. And I think that the solving activity is something like very essential as a mythic activity in the society. We are happy that even if no one knows how to solve the problem of the COVID, to see that the government try to do this. Trying have a performative political activity on the ordering society. I don't know if you understand what I mean. We are happy that there is someone who drives a car, even if we know that they don't know how to drive. And I think that they try all the fact that they begin again and again, and every election you have people who say, we solve the poverty, we fight against inequality, so we blah, 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 blah. So, and they never do this, but in the same time, people continue to accept and to do again, or sometimes there is an innovation who arrives there. They never arrive, I arrive, but after they don't arrive. So I think that the political activity have something like this. Its policy never solves the big problem, but in the same time, the fact that we, all people, all the political activity consists to try, contribute to satisfy the society. I don't know, you know what I mean? Okay, we are happy to say that there is always this. We try everything. If not, a revolt everywhere, you know what I mean?
But at the end, we as society are also dreamers.
But not so much, finally. Because well, you know, there is this wonderful text of Lévi-Strauss about the Père Noël, about the how you say in English?
Santa Claus.
Santa Claus, thank you.
Santa Claus. Okay.
Everyone knows that it's every adult knows that it's a liar that they use, but we need it in the society. We need it for the transfer from children to adolescents, for a lot of things. So we need our meat. And the meat of the government solve the problem is a kind of meat. It's not mean that the government do nothing. You know what I mean? And I think we need to think little.
But
this is why I say I agree and disagree with you. I think that, sure, people not solve the problem. But then at the same time, that the fact that they try to do all the time contribute to stabilize the society.
But I'm not talking about Santa Claus. I'm talking about some kind of society that can be an hologram, for example. And maybe, why not, in the future we have hologrammatic policies, you know?
That would be an innovation, Monique.
Yes. Maybe with holograms we can solve all the problems.
You know, we have virtual money now, so it's the beginning.
Thank you, Hans. And I'm sorry if you're not pronouncing your name properly.
Hi, it's okay. Ande. It's fine. Hi, thank you very much. In fact, I have a more methodological question. We started doing a study on sustainability policies of Turkish firms. I'm from Turkey. And it will be a critical study because I don't like the concept of sustainability and how they combine sustainability with innovation. What impact we are looking for? Are they measuring the outcomes of innovation, and or are they trying to innovate something in a way that nourishes the environment rather than sustaining it? So something like that. But my question is, beyond that, as Carolina said, they are mostly isomorphic, the policies. Everybody is caring about the nature and the society. But what would you recommend us about the discourse analysis? How should we start? I mean, we started reading the policies, but I mean, like step by step, what would you recommend? Thank you.
So about the first point, I can say that sustainable innovation, all this concept is very useful because it's unclear about what is it. So even more concept is unclear, more people can investigate them and create like a movement around them because they can have their own meaning about this. So This is why it's, for me, it's interesting to observe it. How I proceed when I study. So I can just give you an example. When I study the shale gas, for example, BAN, my main idea is really, it's in the middle between the historian and the political scientist. I think that I really need to, hello. we really need to looking for where was the space of debate, where a debate take place about something, about a proposal, for example. For example, if I use the example of shale gas, so I observe that the government take 4 positions, and I try to understand, to come back and to see where was the discuss this proposal. And I think that it's a long process of investigation. It's one of also my difference with a lot of colleagues on policy studies. I remember one famous name of policy studies who say, but Philippe, what you do on shale gas, how many times you need? I say, 2 or 3 years. He say, okay, and me, I have 15 days for my case. It's a way you study that. So if you want to study, what I think is the power is everywhere if you see it, but you need to observe in the micro system, not the, in the micro system, you have always, I think we say so many things which is wrong. So what I try to understand is, I generally begin by the bureaucracy because it's a more easy thing. There is an organization and I begin by the office and I, after interview the office, the people inside the office, I try to see the newspaper. I also consult the archive of the government. Sometimes I arrive to access. In the shale gas, I arrive to access. It's really an amazing thing. But for instance, for the economical policy, I don't arrive. It's, for example, the note that a ministry gives to the prime minister to say, hey, you need to do this, or a note that the cabinet gives to the minister itself. So there is all these people in the bureaucracy make politics all the time. So it's really funny. So what I think is reconsidering the trajectory of a proposal, where this proposal take place, who have defined them. I like when I arrive, for example, for a text of law, when I arrive to have the 10 version of the text of law, who have used the pen to add this word, to delay this word, what was the where was the debate for this word? This, and you know, I think that a proposal make a trajectory in different space in the same time, and it's not monodistant, you know, it's not one pathway. And I try to reconstitute this. It's a long investigation about this. When I and I to begin, so I always begin by a media, a newspaper analyze. But I always be careful about the newspaper analyze, because what say an article on newspaper? It say what the journalist want to say. What you know about the process of the journalist when he write an article. Sometimes I interview some journalists because I like also understand the process of mediatization. It was funny because in my case of shale gas, for example, in the same journal, Le Monde, which is one of the most famous journal in France, you have article for shale gas and against shale gas. Not the same day, but, and you say, why? How I can interpret that? But you understand after when you make investigation, but in reality, inside Le Monde, you have the department of environment and you have the journalists of the department of energy. And they have not the same network. They have not the same information coming from the same space and they have not the same position. The journalists who take in charge the environment said to me, if I don't explain that shale gas is an environmental problem, I can't publish my article because I'm not legitimate for this. So this is why I don't want to have a big analyze discourse when you don't arrive to understand the subtlety of the process. But for example, when I study article, I separate 2 periods. I separate the period when there is only few articles. Why this article arrived? What was the way that the journalist arrived to say something about something? And it's interesting to observe that they have more or less the same methods. They interview more or less the same people and create this. And after you have when every media publish the same thing, it's another part. And the second thing is, okay, go in bureaucracy, go in the group all people and try to understand what is not know what is think what each people think, or what because it's also a lot of problem in interview. I think that I read a lot of interview which is for me not methodological stable. The main idea is really to take the interviewer as witnesses of what he has participated, what discursive practice he have assist concretely. Where and where, at what moment? He not remember everything, but I make the hypothesis that he remember some key element. Some, you know, sometimes there is that people say, "Oh, I remember when this the person from Total arrived to present to discuss with me about having shale gas or not." So this is the key moment where the proposal take place, and when you see the power dimension which take place, and sometimes it's also. I like the idea of symmetry of fail of proposal. Sometimes it's Kobel there who say that. No, it's Barak and Barat who say sometimes the power, you can read more the power on the proposal who fail than on the proposal who succeeds. So it's a very meticulous thing. And I really agree with you, Ander, that it's really important. The methodological dimension is really, really important. And we not. Take enough time on this, on the serious of the, specifically in qualitative view, because so there is a quantitative view who try to make something like scientific with a lot of things like that, and we in qualitative we need to be really 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 rigorous to be available to say something interesting.
So what I understand what you're saying is. In discursive analysis, we have to position our research with time and position and space and maybe history.
Yeah, exactly.
Not just reading the documents or making the interview.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It's the essential of discursive practice has never been written and is not in public. So, and this is where the policy process takes place. And this is a problem we have. And we need to reconstitute, not all, because we are not historian, but the key one. And even defining the key one is problematic, but it's interesting.
So what you're, okay. Instead of doing like 10 companies, maybe we should focus on a few companies.
Mm. Sure. Okay. Sometimes you understand more things by following a little things, but when you can better observe who have. I can continue to come back in my four solution. Each solution have a different pathway. Was not created by the same people.
Okay.
And was not defined by the same people, and have not the same pathway as the same people. And at the end, it becomes the new policy.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Anyone else?
Isabelle.
Go on, Isabelle.
Oui, bonjour, Monsieur Zitoun. Je ne sais pas si je prononce bien votre nom en français. Je suis du Québec. Je travaille sur le tourisme. Je me présente en français. Je traduis à l'instant pour les collègues. I'll just have introduce myself in French with Professor Zitoun because. I can. And then I'll translate, of course, for everyone. Je travaille sur le tourisme, principalement en contexte québécois. Je suis pas du tout une spécialiste de l'analyse du discours, mais bien entendu, ça trouve un peu sa place quand on travaille sur le discours. Et puis, j'aimerais reboucler la boucle peut-être sur l'innovation, justement. Vous avez mentionné que l'innovation, qu'on crée des fois un problème pour une solution, mais j'ai l'impression aussi, dans ce que j'étudie, en tout cas le tourisme, il y a l'impératif d'innovation. Alors, on a toujours la même solution pour tous les problèmes, qui est cette innovation. J'aurais aimé vous entendre sur le sujet. Je vais traduire ma question pour les autres participants.
So I was telling him I work on tourism in the context of
North America. I'm from Quebec City in Canada. And I was totally interested in hearing Professor Zitoun saying that people and politicians and maybe systems create problems because they have a solution. But to circle back to innovation and maybe a critical view of innovation, I also seem to observe in my work that we also always have the same solution to problems, and it's innovation. So for instance, in coming out of the COVID crisis, tourism is struggling and trying to find ways to emerge back. And so of course, all the policies and financing is about innovation and how we can position, how every destination can be positioned as the most innovative. So I was interested to hearing Professor Zitoun about that.
So I don't know exactly the tourism policy about Quebec, a little bit because we organized a conference in Montreal 2 years ago. So we work a little bit with the tourism office. There is two things in what you say, and maybe after I need to have more explanation. What is sure is what we observe is there is largely less number of solutions than the number of problems to solve. This is something, create a new solution is very, very difficult. So the recycling system is really important because we have not, there is not so many solution available in the situation. So the fact that people recycling the same solution a lot of time, it's not is linked to this gap between the number of issue and the number of solution existing in the repertory. But what I observe generally, I don't know in this case, is the even if there is a recycling process, the process I call the taming the wild problem, have always a cost. When I mean that the solution is never exactly the same. The problem is redefined, clearly, is not the wild problem, and the solution is always need to be adapted and is never exactly the same but in the beginning. So I mean, for example, that in case of I study I evoke the tramway in Paris. What is interesting is clearly that the idea to make a tramway in Paris was an old project. And there is a group of specialists who have this project since 1970. When they build this project, they build this project to solve two problems, to solve a problem of circularity of Paris and a problem about a landscape which is really not used, but they need to use. But they never arrived to go out the project. What is interesting is in 1995, a new problem emerged. It's a pollution problem in Paris. And the ability of these people is to recycling their old solution of tramway to this new problem. So each time you look at any report before 1995, no one say that the tramway solves the problem of pollution or is for the problem of solution. And after 1995, the tramway is the solution of the pollution. But so this is the first thing. So the recycling is really classical. And I think this is one of the reasons people is really attached to solution and there is not so many. But each time you make this investment, which is not just a coupling process. This is why I'm not agree with Kingdom, you say it's a coupling. It's not only a coupling problem. You need not only to redefine the problem itself, you need also to redefine the solution. And there is a lot of things I don't enter in the detail, but between the tramway before 1995 and the tramway after, it's not the same pathway. And people who want the tramway before defend the pathway will not win. Because with the new problem, a new pathway arrives also as a credible solution. So it's not just a detail about a little change. It's an important change. So this is why I think that the recycling, you're right, recycling is all the time. But I think you need to observe more precisely what is the cost of the recycling and how the solution have little change. And sometimes little change can become important change. But I don't know the case of what you evoke. But even if you say solution is always innovation, you can put a lot of things behind this.
Thank you.
Thank you again, Professor. Thank you again, all the attendees. Hope to see you all around here, online or maybe presentially. Bye-bye.
Bye.